Ladies and gentlemen, I thought this evening that I'd introduce this program myself and come down and say a few words, true or false, about each particular piece that we're singing. Some of them we shall sing in groups, and some we shall sing as individual items. Mr. Small is absolutely right. We are very privileged to be in this vast open space, and it is for a vast open space of St. Paul's, London, that this first item was written by its organist, Sir John Stainer. You'll know it was written for St. Paul's when you get to the words, "and the house was filled with smoke." Not only for that reason, but also because it's designed for the unique acoustic of St. Paul's. You have to wait until the echo has gone down the nave for about 7 seconds and then carry on with the rest of the anthem. A piece written for Trinity Sunday, a good opening piece to blow away the cobwebs of both audience and choir, "I Saw the Lord." You're not allowed to do that. Just across the road from where we live in London is a bombed church. It's called Christ Church, Newgate Street. It was bombed in the last war and was never rebuilt. One of its most famous organists was Jonathan Battishill. Jonathan Battishill is also commemorated in the crypt of St Paul's. He was a chorister of St Paul's, and he wrote this anthem for St Paul's Cathedral. Now, how do I know that? Well, again, it stops and starts, and it's obvious that he is using that rather unique acoustic to create a dramatic effect. You'll see what I mean when we get to the words, "Where is thy zeal and thy strength?" This wonderful piece in a minor key, but with so many colours in it. O Lord, look down from heaven.
Thank you.
Those of you who came to Matins this morning will remember, seems a long time ago now, but it was today, that we sang it with the men only in the choir. And I thought that we might put a men only item in this evening and a boys' voices only item. More of the boys' voices item later. There are many connections, of course, with Queen Elizabeth and St. Paul's. The Jubilee service of Queen Elizabeth II was held in St. Paul's in 1977. The Thanksgiving service for the 80th birthday of Queen Elizabeth the Queen Mother will be held in St. Paul's on the 15th of July, and we hope will be brought to America by television. And this particular piece has nothing to do with either of those queens. It's Queen Elizabeth I. But nevertheless, it's a very apposite prayer. O Lord, make thy servant Elizabeth to rejoice in thy strength. And we're going to follow that with one of William Byrd's greatest single works anyway. Laudibus in Sanctis is a setting of Psalm 150. I think looking at the score, you can say it's a reasonably virtuosic piece for all members of the choir. It has rhythm in it, it has a sort of gentleness in it, has calm in it, has so many moods in it, but it's one of his very, very greatest works. First of all, O Lord, make thy servant Elizabeth.
Thank you.
phone rang at home, and it was about 2 o'clock in the morning. And Lyle Haggard said, "You will have to do another concert." And like most things, he said, "You will have to give me a program very quickly." And like most things, I didn't. I forgot to give it to him till we got here. I said to him, "We would like to include an organ solo. Some Bach, I suspect." "Oh," he said, "I'm not sure that you ought to include some Bach. But when I spoke to John Scott, we discussed the program, and we thought that this next piece not only stands on its own as an organ masterpiece, but also it fits in very well with the scheme of tonight's program, Fantasia on Komm, heiliger Geist."
Thank you.
You're probably busy asking yourself the question, who is Mark Blatchly? Well, Mark Blatchly first appeared in my life as a young, ginger-haired child of 8 when he came to be a chorister at Guildford Cathedral. And his father had moved to a school nearby to teach. He sang in the choir till he was 13 and then left. And I heard no more until he was about to leave Charterhouse. And his father rang me up and said, could he possibly come and do something at St Paul's, until he went up to Christ Church, Oxford, where he is now an organ scholar. And so he came for a year to St Paul's. And every member of this choir who was in the choir at that time were confirmed that his ability showed straight away as soon as he got onto the organ in our magnificent cathedral. He has a rare gift for writing for voices. Although he's had no formal training as such, he's receiving that now at the University of Oxford. This is an American premiere, or premiere, whatever you call it, and it is... Sorry. And it... I'll get it for the evening girls. And it is written for our wonderful building. You have to imagine a dark winter's afternoon and evensong being sung in St Paul's with just the boys' voices for whom this piece was written. It's the words of the Magnificat, of course, and written for choir and organ. Mark Blatchly's Magnificat.
I'm
That piece was written as a leaving present by Mark Blatchly, and I always feel it's significant that he'd been brought up in a tradition which happened to embrace the next piece as well. I don't know why I feel there is a connection, but when I look for a piece with which to end the first half of our concert, to follow that, this particular piece came to mind. It also has a word theme link with the second half of the program, with one of the Healey Willan motets. It's Patrick Hadley's only well-known anthem. There are other anthems, including some beautiful carol settings, but this is the one that English cathedral choirs sing, and sing with, I think, a great deal of understanding. My beloved spake and said unto me, rise up, my love, my fair one, and come away.
Oh,
Don't go away, we're just going off to learn the second half of the program. Ladies and gentlemen, it's not that I'm pushing you to sit down, it's just that we've sung the first piece of the second half, you missed it at the back. We're going to sing these first two items as a group. There are a number of Bruckner motets, but we've only brought these two with us. Again, like the Battishill piece, and indeed the Seder piece, they rely on space, and this is the ideal building for them. Particularly in the Christus, factus, iste, which is a setting for Maundy Thursday. One of my strongest remembrances of Christus, factus, iste was sung when we sang it in the crypt of St Paul's Cathedral, at a Maundy Thursday service last year. We retreated from the crypt and sang it in the most resonant part, away from the actual church where they were stripping the altar. It's meant to be sung at this most serious time of year. First of all, the rather shorter Locus, iste, our Deo factus est. This place was made by God a priceless mystery. It is without reproof. settings for cathedrals in England are many, but these early anthems, the four early anthems, dedicated to Sir Thomas Armstrong, who was then organist of Christ Church, Oxford, still stand out as masterpieces in their own right. There's nothing I can say about this music. It speaks for itself.
Thank you.
hospitality since we have been here, in the short time we've been here, and at a dinner given for us this evening before we came here, our gracious host happened to say to me, I wish you would sing some Christmas carols. That's what I'd like to hear you sing. Now, Christmas carols in this heat are not always sung in the best, with the best of feet. When I was organist at Guildford Cathedral, we made a carol record, which was made in the height of summer. I remember it terribly well because we stood on the steps in our shirt sleeves, the perspiration running down our faces, trying to sing with feeling about the sea amid the winter snow. Even in this heat, I felt I wanted to sing these particular pieces. One you may know, one you may not know. The Howells, again, I can say nothing, it says it all musically. One of his most exquisite pieces, A Spotless Rose, followed by one of Kenneth Leighton's most exquisite pieces, Lully, Lulla, one of three carols he wrote. This is number two. You'll be hearing more Kenneth Leighton, those of you who are on the convention, tomorrow morning in the workshop when we sing Kenneth Leighton's setting of the Te Deum, among other Te Deums, the theme of this week being Te Deum, of course. First of all, A Spotless Rose, and then Lully, Lulla.
Thank you.
be ungracious of me not to tell you that the baritone soloist in The Spotless Rose of Geoffrey Shaw and the treble soloist in the last one, Paul Phoenix. This is the second organ solo, and it's a piece I always longed to hear John Scott play. When he said he's going to play it, I thought, right, this is where I sit down and leave him to do the work at this very moment. Transport de joie by Messiaen.
Thank you.
saw the convention program before it was finalized will know that we were due to sing in the Healey Willan concert. Mercifully, we didn't have to do that as well as this concert, and Monday night, and yesterday, and tomorrow, and the next day, and so on. And I am told, although I haven't yet heard, that you have had some wonderful singing in those concerts from the Omar Isla singers. Now, we are going into Canada on Saturday morning, and we felt that we should sing some Healey Willan, and we were actually advised to sing these three motets by the man who's arranged our visit to Canada. Now, they're not among the best known of Healey Willan pieces. They are miniatures, really very, very beautiful and moving miniatures. They've been arranged so that the first two go as a little group and then the last one stands on its own. The work of a real craftsman in writing for voices. Three motets by Healey Willan.
Thank you.
finally, I have to confess, one of my favourite pieces. I didn't put it in for that reason. I wanted us to end with something that perhaps, if I may pay tribute to the people sitting behind me, is indicative of this rather special quality that St Paul's Cathedral Choir has vocally. That feeling of power when it's needed, but that feeling of floating the sound when it's not needed. This anthem has it all. You've got everything from the triple forte is right down to the disappearing act at the end. So make the most of it. Now, it just so happens that I've met so many people in the Leamington Hotel who said to me, would you, if we persuaded you, sing the Bernard Rose piece that you sang the other night, the feast song for St. Cecilia? What I didn't say the other night, because I wasn't allowed to introduce anything on such a formal occasion, was that this poem is part of the Rose family. In fact, I'm not related to Bernard Rose, but his son Gregory, who is himself an accomplished musician, conductor, and singer, wrote the poem for this piece, and father, Bernard Rose, set the music to be sung by the combined choirs of Westminster Abbey and St. Paul's at one of the annual services for St. Cecilia time. I didn't conduct their first performance. Douglas Guest, the organist of Westminster Abbey, conducted the first performance. I sat in the congregation and was spellbound by this piece. Bernard Rose is a great craftsman, another craftsman. We've had the work of a lot of real craftsmen tonight when writing for voices. You would like us to sing that piece, I take it.